Hey, what's up everyone? Bill Lethman here for Money Evolution. In today's video, I'm going to be helping you to answer the question, how much money should you be saving in your 401k plan? So in today's video, I'm actually going to break this down into kind of four key components. Number one, we're going to talk about how much money you should be saving for retirement. I think that's a very important place to start. We're also going to be talking about some of the contribution limits, not only for your 401k plan, but also for some of the other retirement plan savings options that you might have. We're going to be talking about Roth versus traditional savings, where maybe is the best place that you should be saving for your particular tax situation. And then we're going to be also talking a little bit about a hierarchy of savings. So is the 401k plan really the best option, or should you be looking at one of these other savings vehicles? So anyway, lots of information here in today's video. But before we get started, go ahead and hit that subscribe button and let's jump right in. So the first question that we want to ask ourselves is, how much money should we be saving for our retirement? Now, I'm not going to get into a whole lot of detail here in today's video. I've explored this topic very extensively in some of our other videos. We'll actually put some links below so you can check those things out. But what you really want to do is have some type of an idea as to, you know, how much money you need to save in order to hit some of your future retirement lifestyle goals. But what I also want you to think about here is creating a little bit of balance, because I think a lot of people become so hyper-focused on saving money for retirement that they oftentimes forego some of that lifestyle stuff today, you know, because you want to balance out, you know, having fun today, but also saving money for the future. But I think, you know, here's a couple of rules of thumb, you know, so if you've, you know, been saving along the way pretty extensively here, I think if you're saving 10% of your gross income as a rule of thumb, I think that's a pretty good place to start. If you feel like maybe you're behind a little bit, you might need to take that up to 15% or 20 or maybe even 25% if you're a little bit behind on some of your retirement savings goals. But 10% would be a good rule of thumb just to start off with. The second thing we want to understand is a little bit about our tax bracket, both today while we're still working, and also run some projections or forecast of what we think our tax bracket is going to be in the future when we're retired and we're starting to withdraw money from our portfolios. So the key thing we want to understand here is, are we going to be in a higher tax bracket in retirement, or are we going to be in a lower tax bracket in retirement? And this is going to be one of the key determining factors for whether or not we're going to save money in a traditional IRA or 401k plan or a Roth 401k or a Roth IRA account. And again, not all 401k plans have a Roth option, so that's something very important there, but we want to understand a little bit about this tax situation so we can maybe decide where we want to direct some of that money. So here's how it works. Basically, if you think you're going to be in a higher tax bracket in retirement than you are today, then it's going to make sense for you to pay the taxes now and put that money into some type of a Roth vehicle where you can take that money out in retirement completely tax-free. On the other hand, if you think you're in a higher tax bracket today and it's going to be lower in retirement, then it might make sense for you to do the traditional option, take that tax deduction today, reduce your taxable income, and then pay the taxes on that later in retirement when you go to withdraw that. But one very important thing that I think you need to analyze as a part of this is looking at your future required minimum distribution. So if you're watching this video, it still may be a long way off, but the IRS mandates that after you turn 70 and a half, that you start liquidating your IRA accounts and your 401k plans and start paying some taxes on that money along the way. And for a lot of people, especially if you've done a really good job saving, that can really potentially push you up into a higher tax bracket. So you want to really kind of explore that. Where's my tax bracket today versus where is that going to be in the future? The last thing I'll say about this is just looking at where our tax rate environment is today in 2019. We've been in a pretty low tax rate environment here really for the last decade or so, but in particular when the 2018 Tax Cuts and Jobs Act went into effect, that effectively lowered tax rates for most of us here as Americans. And so if those tax rates are going to go up after 2025, which is what they're scheduled to do, then all of us could be facing some higher tax rates in the future. So again, that kind of leans a little bit more, in my opinion, towards the Roth contribution, but you want to look at your specific situation and see what maybe is best for you. Okay, so now let's start talking about what I call the hierarchy of retirement plan savings. In other words, where do I think are some of the most advantageous places that you should be saving your money for retirement? So I think number one on this list has to be contributing to your 401k plan at least enough to get the full matching contribution. So if your company is putting any money into your 401k plan on your behalf, matching you 50 cents on the dollar or dollar for dollar, whatever that is, I think it absolutely makes 100% sense to contribute to that 401k plan to at least be able to get that full matching contribution. It really doesn't make any difference if you want to do the Roth contribution or the traditional contribution. I think either way is fine, but just make sure you're doing enough to at least get that match. Number two on this list, I think, is a Roth IRA account. Now, again, this is going to kind of go back into why we talked about Roth versus traditional, but assuming that a Roth IRA or Roth 401k plan makes sense, I think a Roth IRA account is a great place to continue saving your money for retirement. So 401k plans tend to be a lot more restrictive on the investment choices and basically what you're able to do with that account. But a Roth IRA account, you can have that Roth IRA basically at any one of, maybe 100 different financial institutions, your local bank or a big financial firm. And depending on where you have that account, in some cases, you could virtually have almost unlimited investment options with that Roth IRA. Now, there are some income restrictions to contributing to a Roth IRA. So not everybody is going to be able to make a contribution directly to a Roth. So if you make over certain amounts, if you make over $120,000 a year as a single individual, your ability to contribute to a Roth starts to get phased out. And if you're over $135,000, you can't contribute to a Roth at all. And if you're married, filing a joint tax return, that phase out begins at $189,000 and completely gets phased out at $199,000. So if you're over those income limits, you're not going to be able to make that contribution directly to a Roth. There are, however, a couple of ways you could still get money into a Roth. We just made a video here a couple days ago called the Backdoor Roth IRA. And so if you want, we'll take a link, we'll put a link down below where you can check out that other video and learn a couple of strategies where you can still get that Roth IRA account contribution. The third type of account that I'd like you to consider as you're starting to save some money for your retirement is kind of a non-traditional one, but it's the HSA or the health savings account. And the reason why I bring this up is because I think there's a lot of very significant tax advantages to an HSA. And also for many of us, our healthcare costs in retirement are likely going to be one of our biggest single expenses, especially for those of you that might be planning to retire before age 65 when Medicare kicks in and you're going to have to go out into the exchanges and purchase healthcare insurance on your own. Having some money kind of banked in one of these HSA accounts could be a very good thing. Now, you have to have a certain type of healthcare plan in order to qualify for an HSA. It basically has to be a high deductible plan. But if you have that as a single, you can contribute up to $3,500 a year for 2019 into an HSA. And if you're on a family plan, you can actually double that to $7,000 a year. So the idea there is obviously that HSA can help you cover some of those medical expenses right now while you're maybe having your co-pays and doctors and prescriptions and things like that. But if you don't use it all, you can also bank that for the future. And ultimately, if you're banking enough of that, it could grow to a pretty sizable amount by the time you retire, and you can use that to pay some of those future healthcare premiums in retirement. Now, HSAs have a really nice tax advantage. Like I said, you not only get a tax deduction for the money that goes in, but you also get that money tax-free when it comes out. So it's actually even a little bit better than a Roth account, where on a Roth, you're paying taxes before the money goes in. You get to take it out tax-free. An HSA is kind of tax-free on both ends. You get to deduct it off your income today and also get to take those tax-free distributions as long as they're used for medical expenses in the future. So if you haven't already, make sure you're taking a look at an HSA, and that's a great account to try to maximize as well. So we talked about making a 401k contribution to make sure you're getting that full company match. I think that's very important. That's free money. We don't want to miss out on that. We also talked about making contributions to a Roth IRA if you qualify for that. Also on Roth IRAs, don't forget about your spouse. Your spouse is also eligible for a Roth IRA account as well. We also talked about the HSA, another great way to get kind of double tax advantage where you're getting the tax advantage going in and coming out as long as it's qualified. And then beyond that, if we we still want to save some additional money, what I would do is go back to the 401k plan. So the 401k plan, one of the advantages, it has some very high contribution limits. So for 2019, if you're under 50 years old, you can contribute up to $19,000 to your 401k plan. If you're 50 years old or older, they give you what's called a catch-up provision, another $6,000 to bring that total up to $25,000. So just one quick note on this, though. Those are combined contribution limits between traditional and Roth. So unfortunately, you don't get the $19,000 in the Roth and another $19,000 in traditional, however you want to split that up. But the total contribution, $19,000 if you're under 50, and if you're over 50 or 50 years old or older, it's $25,000 a year. So that would be the next place that I would start to save some money for your retirement. The last type of savings account that I want to talk about here as it pertains to putting money away for your retirement is something that not everybody is going to have access to, but certain 401k plans that are out there allow for what are known as after-tax contributions to your employer-sponsored plan. And up until relatively recently, this was something we didn't really pay necessarily a lot of attention to. There was really not really any significant advantages to it. Because basically, an after-tax savings account works like this. You put money into the account. Unfortunately, you don't get any tax advantage as the money goes in. And then that money grows tax-deferred until the time when you pull that money out. The one advantage is you don't have to pay any taxes on that those gains or interest payments along the way, but you do have to pay taxes on whatever that account grew to as you're pulling that money out. So you can see, compared to some of the other options that we've already talked about, really not a lot of advantages. But for those of you that have already exhausted those first couple options that we talked about here and you still want to save some additional money, what an after-tax account can allow you to do is put money into that account, and due to a recent tax ruling in 2014, the IRS now says that you can take those after-tax monies that you have in a company-sponsored plan and roll those directly over to a Roth IRA. In fact, that's something I talk about a little bit more extensively in our backdoor Roth IRA video, but this is what we call sometimes a mega backdoor Roth IRA because the contribution limits are very, very generous on this. So we talked about the $19,000 if you're under 50 and the $25,000 if you're 50 years old or older. What the IRS actually says is that your contribution limits for the total monies going into your company-sponsored plan in any given year for 2019 are $56,000 if you're under 50 years old, and it's $62,000 if you're 50 years old or older. And how that breaks down is that $56,000 or $62,000 limit is going to be a breakdown of your contributions, which are limited if you're under 50 to $19,000 a year, plus any company contributions that they put in. And whatever that difference is, you can contribute up to that $56,000. So for some people, you might have the ability to put, you know, maybe, you know, $20,000 or $30,000, depending on how much money your company is matching, could give you a very big ability to put money into that account. And then what we typically will do is we'll roll that money out over into an IRA account or Roth IRA account so that you can get the tax advantages of the Roth IRA account. And again, there's no income restrictions on this. So somebody can do this whether you make $50,000 a year or $500,000 a year. There's no income restrictions on doing this mega backdoor Roth IRA contributions. So one last thing as we wrap up the video here. What I'd like you to do is think a little bit about how you have some of your money distributed across what we call the three main tax buckets. So on one hand, we have your traditional bucket. That's the tax later accounts. Those are traditional IRAs and 401k plans. And as you withdraw that money in retirement, you're going to have to pay some taxes as that money comes out. You also might have some money in a Roth IRA or Roth 401k. Those are tax-free distributions in retirement. And you also might have some money in what are known as non-retirement accounts. So that's money that you have to pay taxes every year on all of the interest, the dividends, the capital gains, short-term, long-term, that you get every single year. So some of you might be thinking, well, hey, this is all great. I can't believe I can put that much money into those retirement accounts, but if I have any more money taken out of my paycheck, I'm not going to be able to cover my basic living expenses. So one thing that we talk to clients about is if you have money over here in some of those non-retirement accounts, as long as it's not taking away from your emergency fund, what you can do is maybe sign up and have more money taken out of your account for a Roth 401k plan or traditional 401k or maybe that after-tax bucket, and then use some of those non-retirement accounts to maybe subsidize some of those living expenses expenses. And what we're doing is actually two things. Number one is we're shifting money over to one of those more tax-advantaged accounts, but we're also reducing a little bit of your tax liability that you have on an annual basis. So that's going to reduce the amount of interest or capital gains that you're going to have to pay taxes on an annual basis. And I think in the long run, that's going to give you a much better tax-advantaged situation. So something to think about there. That's something we talk about all the time with our clients. Anyway, hope you got some great value out of today's video. Remember, hit that subscribe button, and I'll see you back here soon in one of our next videos.